Morning, rather good afternoon. My name is Dr. Santosh Jacob. Today the class is for all junior residents, registrars, wherever you are in India, all over the world. This will be a series of classes about COVID-19 and how junior residents, registrars should learn and deal with COVID-19. Now, as all of you know, today we will be talking about mucormycosis. Mucormycosis is a fungus. Somebody get me a pen, it's not writing. Mucormycosis is a fungus. It is there in India, in the atmosphere. It is there in the gardens. It is there wherever there is any organic food material. For example, if there is a rotten fruit or an apple, if there is any decaying organic matter, in those areas there will be fungus and also mucor. Now, we need to remember these terms. One is COVID-19. The other one is COVID-19 sepsis, and the other one is diabetes. It is extremely important for us, in order for us to understand what is mucormycosis and why is it important, we need to understand the difference between the three terms. Now, COVID-19 is just the disease. It is when somebody just has fever, cough, minimal lung involvement, saturation is only around 94-95, and they improve. That is COVID-19. Then, now you have something called COVID-19 sepsis. All of you are in wards, all of you are in the ICU. What you see in the ICU, when somebody has non-invasive ventilation or oxygenation for a long time, and you see that the WBC is elevated, whatever you do, respiratory rate is elevated, they have fever, sometimes we put them on intubation, ECMO, CRRT, anything in which the patient is in the ICU for more than 7 days with altered blood values, that is increased WBC, increased IL-6, anything which involves the cytokine storm, and where they are treated with antibiotics in order to improve their status, it can be called as COVID-19 sepsis. Now, as all of you have seen in the ICUs, when somebody is obese, somebody is an uncontrolled diabetic, how are the results? Results are extremely poor. They deteriorate very fast. Before we learn about mucormycosis, you have to know what is it in these ICU COVID sepsis patients which is happening, that mucormycosis is going and attacking them. In order to understand this, you have to know that in India, diabetes is the fastest growing epidemic. There are 77 million diabetics, and in that 50% of them are on very bad glycemic control, and some of them are not even aware that they are diabetics. In general, mucormycosis in India is there at a number of 140 per million. And this is the highest in the world. The rest of the world, the more common infection is aspergillosis. Okay, but in India it is mucormycosis. Why is it more in India? It is more in India because we have open dustbins. Okay, we use a lot of decaying organic matter. Mucormycosis is there even in cow dung. So, as you generally know, India generally is much more not as clean as other nations. And as a result, the number of fungi in the air itself is higher. When you have a good immune system, our immune system is strong enough in order to ward off all the fungi which are in the air. That's why even when you walk on cow dung, you don't get mucormycosis in general. When your immune cells are strong, when your immune cells are well fed. But in COVID-19 sepsis, five things happen. First is called immune dysregulation. It's very important. It's called immune dysregulation. Second thing which very few people understand is that there is loss of ciliary function. Now, what is cilia? From the nose into the respiratory tract, down to the lungs, into the alveoli, we have hairs, okay, which move upwards, which do not allow toxins or organisms to enter inside. After COVID, your cilia is done. Then you have vasculitis all over, which is inflammation of your blood vessels. Finally, you have thrombosis, which is clots. And in all this, because of the breathing difficulty, patients are unable to eat. You're seeing that, no, with oxygen, everybody is really burnt inside. Then there is malnourishment. And all this, along with continuous oxygenation, CRRT, steroids, IL-6 inhibitors, TNF-alpha inhibitors, with all this, what happens is you have a done and dusted immune system. Once you recover from COVID, the immune system which you take back home is an immune system which is just alive. It's not strong. So when that immune system goes out and exposes itself to the fungi which are normally there in India, the immune system does not have the capacity to even fight the mucormycosis. And so, mucor enters into the lung just like it does with COVID-19. It's nasal and it's also in the skin, but primarily through the nose, it either goes up or it goes down into the lung. Just remember that. We will talk about it later. Duster I need next. Okay? Now, you have a weakened immune system and then you're also diabetic. So if you're diabetic, what happens is you have to remember fungi grow beautifully on acidic medium. So when you have diabetes in general, your body is acidotic, because when you have uncontrolled diabetes, you get diabetic ketoacidosis. So, your body is acidotic. So anytime you do not have proper sugar control, so in the ward, in the ICU, if you see HbA1c 13.1, you already know that this person is acidotic. You should immediately think that, okay, I have to suspect mucormycosis. Alright? Then the other thing, in diabetes, what happens is, see, I believe that we have to understand everything at a cellular level in order to understand how to treat COVID. So, this point, in diabetes, what happens, why we say that diabetics have a lower immunity? It is because we have on our endothelium a receptor called GP32. When you have diabetes, this receptor's expression is reduced. So, your immune cells, the swallowing capacity, the capacity to send out chemicals in order to kill the fungi or the bacteria are lost in diabetes. So, acidotic, diabetic, this two put together with the incidence of mucormycosis already in India makes it a very devastating combination. So, in this introduction, you need to understand that COVID-19, sepsis, diabetes. If you see this combination in the ICU, all of you should develop a very high suspicion of mucormycosis. So in this first slide rather, okay, because I prefer teaching the old style, I think it's easier. In this first slide, what you should understand is where there is COVID-19, where there is COVID-19 sepsis, where there is diabetes which is uncontrolled, you have to think that the body has lower immunity because of non-expression of the endothelial receptors, and also the body is acidotic. So both put together, think fungal infections, think mucormycosis, because it is happening in India now. Now, we will just understand it by answering 5 questions. What is mucormycosis? So basically, mucormycosis is a fungus. It is a mold. It grows everywhere. It just needs moist, humid, warm temperature. So tell me places which are moist, humid and warm. Hospitals, hospital wards, gardens, animal husbandries, okay, wherever you have to go and work where there is organic matter. So if a patient is somebody who has come from not the city but in a place where there are cows or other animals or dustbins are open, always think of mucormycosis. So the answer to what is mucormycosis is, it is a fungus. It is actually a ubiquitous mold, that is the term. And you have to understand that in India, all over the world, there are 2 fungal infections which are complicating COVID. One is CAP, that is COVID associated pulmonary aspergillosis, and the next one is mucor. And in India, don't think Kappa, think mucormycosis. Okay, now how do you identify if it is mucormycosis? Answer is clinically. You can identify it clinically. I will also tell you how to diagnose it, but unless you have a high degree of clinical suspicion, it will be almost impossible. So what all can happen? In order to understand what all can happen, before that I will just tell you the pathology. So it's a fungus. Have you seen fungus which is growing on fruits? You know, it will be like that, grayish, brown. It's exactly like that, and it happens inside our nasal, orbital, cranial and pulmonary cavities. Just remember that. The same fungus in mucormycosis, in COVID sepsis, happens in the orbital, rhino, cranial area and the pulmonary area, which means you have fungal growth just like it is there on the fruits, on the decayed organic matter inside our sinuses, inside our nose. So tell me guys, what is Little's area? Does anybody know what is the importance of Little's area? Okay. So Little's area is a very vascular area in the front of the face, this area. So this area has blood vessels which go through a plate known as the cribriform plate. So when there is mucor in this region, it first infiltrates the outer, the mucosa, and once it enters the cribriform plate, the cribriform plate is the plate which is separating your brain from your nasal cavity, and it is a perforated plate. So if the mucor fills up this area, then it can easily spread to the cranial region, and once that happens, you yourself can now tell me all the symptoms. So it starts in the nose. So how do you think it will start? It will start with a stuffy nose, it will start with a running nose, they will have a blocked nose, then it fills up the sinuses. So think like sinusitis, they will have headaches, they will feel heavy in the head. So when they say this, don't think azithromycin. in the COVID ICU, first thing, mucormycosis, ask for history. Do you have a garden? Do you have animals? Do you work with cow dung? You know, because in the villages, they use that for fuel. So any dung rather, it's there on decaying organic matter and on any dung, okay? So then they could have swelling in the face, okay? Swelling in the face. Then pulmonary features, very similar to COVID. Now you have to understand that at this stage, you have to diagnose and you have to start treating, because the next stage where you have tissue necrosis, mucormycosis goes and it kills the tissue. When you have tissue necrosis, that's when symptoms will be obvious. You'll have black fluid pouring out. You'll have dark black tissue. At that time, it's too late, because already the fungus has spread through enough in order to come out of the spaces. You understand? The fungus has gone inside, filled up enough that it is coming out. So we cannot wait till it is that long, because treatment is easy. So after this, it just goes to black discharge, tissue necrosis, swelling of the face, infection of the eyes, swelling of the eyes, periorbital edema, and then just black stuff keeps coming out from every orifice. You also have a loss of cranial nerve function once in a while. Now I'm going to go straight to diagnosis and treatment, because I think that is enough. So diagnosis, guys, clinical suspicion first. Then you have to know this. So you can do a biopsy, okay, which is an open biopsy. It will be there, take the tissue, and you can see septate hyphae in the biopsy. Then KOH mount and calcofluor strain. And I'm just going to tell you guys a point, because an intensivist told me you have to tell this to your registrars. So now, if you are suspecting aspergillosis, okay, in an intensive care unit, wherever you are, in aspergillosis, how do you differentiate between Kappa, that is COVID-associated pulmonary aspergillosis, and mucormycosis? Is there is a stain known as a galactoman stain and a beta-glucan stain. Generally, just understand this, generally it will be positive in Kappa, okay, that is aspergillosis. Generally it will be positive in aspergillosis. But when you are giving strong antibiotics, even if there is no aspergillosis and there is just mucor, it could appear as false positive. In India, the possibility of Kappa being there is much lesser than mucormycosis. So always when you suspect, especially in South India, in Andhra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, where the incidence is already high, better suspect mucormycosis. So diagnosis, clinical suspicion is the first. Then by biopsy, KOH mount and calcofluor strain. And how to differentiate between Kappa and mucor. And always remember, when you're using antibiotics, IL-6, suppressants, there could be a false positive, but still don't think Kappa, think mucor, because it is common in India. Now coming to treatment. Treatment is very simple. Actually, you use amphotericin B. You have to know that you have to use liposomal. The commonest, most easily available drug is amphotericin B liposomal. And I'm also going to give you the dose. The dose is 1.5 to 5 mg per kg body weight. You can give it in two divided doses. Now with amphotericin B, you always have to pay attention to make sure that their renal and liver functions are not worsening because amphotericin B has a tendency to do that. And after that, there is this drug called posaconazole and ivasconazole. Now, the dosage of posaconazole is 300 mg per day. It can be given in divided doses, okay? And then you have a lot of adjuvant treatments. Surgical debridement is very, very important because it's a fungus. So if there is a lot of it, you need to give a lot of antifungals, and it's accessible. If you remove it, it will be easier, but it's a very, very defiguring surgery because you're removing the nose and debriding of the necrotic tissue. So the goal of this lecture is to make sure that as residents, you do not miss an opportunity to alert your consultants. Okay, that is the idea of this entire lecture. So amphotericin B, posaconazole, and ivasconazole. There is also something known as adjuvant therapies for this. So in this adjuvant therapy, there are statins, there is hyperbaric oxygen therapy, and then there is caspofungin. It's another medication. Now there's a controversy whether chelating agents like dextromethorphan are useful. So I went through a journal where it clearly says that chelating iron agents like dextromethorphan improve the results only in animals and not in human beings. So depending upon your institution, you can choose to use dextromethorphan as an adjuvant or not. Now the whole idea is, if possible, I would have liked to show all of you images of how bad mucormycosis can be. Okay, just go back, take your phones, Google it and see. It's really, really bad. So as soon as you guys suspect, identify, and if justified, talk to your consultant and start the patient early on amphotericin or posaconazole. You guys might easily save the lives of a lot of patients, because many of them, everybody who goes through COVID-19 sepsis has a very weak immune system. And a few points which I would like all of you to take is, why did I talk that much about aspergillosis? You guys, where we don't see aspergillosis at all. The reason why I spoke about it is, if you use the drug called voriconazole for aspergillosis instead of drugs for mucor, you will worsen the mucor. So it's a mistake you really can't make and correct. So suspect, learn, and treat. Any questions? I'll take now. All right, guys, thank you very much. This is the end of mucormycosis, and any of medical students or junior doctors who are listening, if you have any doubts, any clarifications, write it down in the questions below. My residents will go through the questions and they will bring them to me. I will answer them before the start of the next class. All right, guys, bye-bye. Thank you for watching.